terrible. You may hate it too. He is pretty good. Do we come up with?
Okay. Heel.
So, now don't say anything, watch. Yeah, so it's no.
Assume it's duty. He'll know if he's in and down, and his head is up, pretty much when you hit the button.
The red one.
Okay, we're live.
Hey guys, how are you? Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, and we're on, what are we on, Facebook Live?
Facebook Live.
Facebook Live, how are you? So happy to see all of you. Dog next to me is Fenton. I've actually not worked with this dog. I actually remain the stranger in the room because I've got awesome staff, and they actually need usually a stranger to, the dog is not familiar with it, that the dog does not train with. But I want to have a little bit of clarification, educational moment, which is really going to help a lot of people out. Two wonderful videos went up this week with Fenton. Fenton, first of all, described, you know, Fenton's past behavior, and his owner made a comment on the video from today. So Fenton would bite everybody that came in the house, rush at them and bite them.
Men especially.
He's a biting dog. No questions asked. No hello. How are you? What's your name? It's like, oh, hey, dude, I'll let you know who I am. And it's called the dog with a mouthful of teeth. So the first video came up with us, with who was handling him at the time? Was it you or Britt?
Me.
Joelle was handling the dog, and then Ben, who dresses up in a raincoat and a mask and a hat, like, you know, walking up going, you know, ah. The dog backs up behind Joelle. Now, let's talk about pressure. That's what I really want to start talking about on this video, is about the concept of pressure. It's important that owners understand pressure. So for instance, when you walk up to a dog and you have your arm out and you like want them to sniff your hand, a lot of times dogs actually don't read that as a good thing. What they see is they see pressure increasing on them, on their space. Everybody remembers the Jerry Seinfeld episode about close talkers. It's sort of like that, but it's actually even worse. So imagine getting punched in the face if you don't like close talkers. Well, dogs will bite. So dogs usually move away pressure a couple of two main ways. They lunge out or they retreat. Now, a lot of times on a leash, they lunge out because that's all they feel they can do. And unfortunately, with a biting dog, that means they bite. Now, so they might lunge out and bite, they might lunge at the end of the leash and bark and growl, but you hold them back, or they might just stand still and growl. Now, we don't want any of those things, okay? But they do it because they're trying to remove pressure. So a lot of times it's like, it's because they're afraid that this is, none of it matters. They're just trying to move the pressure source away. Dog, kid, human, anything. Now, what we're doing is, you're seeing in that video, and there's a great narrative, by the way. Joelle, what I'd like everyone to do is, I want, unless it's like a video of like a bunch of dogs in the play yard, like smiling or having a good time, there's a short narrative. But when you see a longer narrative, it's written usually by Joelle, and she does a really good job explaining what we are doing. Dogs are with us, and there sort of isn't an ever an end in dog training. But the product, we'll call the product that we're delivering, meaning, oh geez, Jeff, you just think dogs are products. No, what I'm saying is, we have taught Fenton, guess what? That's not acceptable, right? You can't do that. But let's show you what is acceptable. Now, obviously, being neutral, going, hey, guy in a scary mask who's literally in my face, it doesn't bother me. Unfortunately, that doesn't always happen. Even the best dogs will jump back a little bit, but a lot of them have something called recovery time. So imagine this, drop a metal bowl on the ground. Like, I don't know how to pick out puppies. That's not what I do, by the way. So that's not what I do. It doesn't make me not a good dog trainer. I just don't pick out puppies. But it's okay for a puppy to move back a little bit and then go investigate. Some puppies run away and hide, and you probably don't want that puppy. Then some puppies go, huh? Now they might be deaf, or they might just be like, that didn't faze me. I'd be careful about that puppy, unless you want it to be a working dog and totally, totally fearless. But what we've taught Fenton to do is, if you're concerned about something, back up. So in the video, you actually see the dog backing up a little bit. Now, I'm not sure if was there a click or a reward, a good. That was rewarded. I think that might be some confusion there. The confusion from people might be like, oh, aren't you reinforcing the fear? No. We are reinforcing the dog backing away from the pressure. It's actually a good thing. Why is it a good thing? Let's remember the opposite. This dog would bite everybody. Like, so right here, pan this. Okay, I haven't worked with this dog. I haven't ever pet this dog. I've never sat this close to this dog. I've never handled this dog. I own the company, I run the company, I travel the world. I've got awesome staff here. So for Fenton to be next to me, a complete stranger, and this dog knows that I'm moving my arms.
Yeah, you're being really animated.
Okay, and I do that on purpose. This dog is very aware. We've taught Fenton to just technically not give a shit. Don't care. Why? Because we want the owning. The dog goes back to the owner's home. Guests come over. We're going to have, we have protocols. There's different levels of protocol. First, we have a 90-day go home. And at the beginning, the dog should be kenneled up and lie down and be quiet. Eventually, the dog should go to place, lie down and be quiet. Is a dog ever going to be able to walk amongst the guests of the home with complete strangers? We don't know. And frankly, I wouldn't trust most dogs that way. Because I don't know what people are going to do. My dogs are very social, but guess what? People come over to the house, guess what? Now's a good time to go out in the play yard. Not bad dog going in the play yard, but it's like, now's a good time. I have no idea what people are going to do. But it's a great thing to just say, you know what? Kennel up, lie down, be quiet. Not, oh my God, you're bad. I don't trust you, go in the kennel. But believe it or not, it's smart saying, I don't trust you, go in your kennel. It's the safest thing. So what we taught the dog to do was back away from pressure. And yes, that's rewarded, and no, we're not rewarding fear. First of all, we don't know if he's afraid. All you're doing is seeing him back up, what we taught him to do. That's something we taught the dog to do. Stop doing the old stuff, which was biting everything and everyone, not everyone, that's a general thing, and back away. That's wonderful. So that's what we taught. So when you watch that video, it's on Facebook and is on Instagram as well. Mm-hmm. Probably on IGTV because it's longer. Okay, that's one video. Now there's another video on out. Now the out video is with Ben and Brittany, two of my trainers. What's really cool about having a male-female staff, and I point that out because it actually makes a difference. And it's not because male trainers are more dominant, but dogs respond differently to men and to women. Considering that a lot of our clientele is female, it's actually would be a disadvantage to have an all-female staff here. You actually also want to have a male because dogs behave differently. That doesn't mean they behave better, it's just they behave differently because they take human energy differently. Now, if you watch and listen to the video, Ben is petting the dog. You can hear him say the word out. It's very clear. The dog moves away. Now, we're not at the beginning stages of this, but there's a long line on the dog. All training involves a leash. Why? Because we're teaching the dog to move away from the person that you said that is saying out to something. At the moment, it's going towards Brittany, but in the real world, it's just gonna move away. So why is this important? So it looks like recall, but listen to the words that are being used. Brittany doesn't say come, Ben says out. That actually is a huge difference. Out means get out of here. So out means drop the ball, drop the bite sleeve, back away from something, or literally get out of here. The way we're teaching out command in this context, and by the way, I'll do some, is there questions coming in? Because I'll do some Q&A at the end of this for a little bit. The reason why we're teaching the out command, it's a very important command. We have clients that are couples, they can't hug, okay? They can't just like, honey, I'm home from work, hug. The dog likes to get in between them. That's sort of like a subtle thing. Some people think it's cute until the couple start hugging, and guess what? Somebody gets bit. In my world, in our world, at Solid Canine Training, and in my seminars, that's popular. We have people that, as soon as they walk down the steps of their house, the dog actually tries to bite them. The family pet. So we also have people who you're sitting down on the couch like this, reading the paper on your laptop, eating a sandwich, reading a book, and the dog just comes over and like, I don't know, tries to like engage in you. And that's not the worst behavior. And you can be proactive. You can actually, you know, tell the dog place or down, but you could also tell the dog out. Out means technically get out of here, and it's not a punisher. So it's just out. As a matter of fact, get out of here. And after a while, believe it or not, the dog usually just goes and lies down somewhere. It's wonderful for children. So imagine a couple of kids sitting down on the ground playing a board game or putting a puzzle together or chit-chatting with their friends or playing a video game or doing whatever, you know, looking at their tablet. So in our household, we'll use that sometimes. Sometimes we'll use that with Angelo when we play Chuck It. Sometimes if Angelo's comes in the, if two or three dogs come over to say hi to him, which are our dogs, and if it's too much for him, and they don't jump on him at all, and they don't lick him, and they won't bite him, but maybe he's like, I don't want all these dogs coming over to me. He says, out, and they all move away. Now, at the very beginning of training, sometimes it looks like they're afraid. How do we do this? We do this with a remote collar. But it's always done, training-wise, it's done in this context, always on a lower level. But once the dog knows it, it can be on a higher level. So we always teach on low level and pattern it, and then we proof it on a higher level. So those are the two videos that I wanted to have a little bit more clarity of, which I love doing. I love doing. And those are right on our Facebook page, which are on Facebook now, and you can watch them and get a little bit more clarity. What's that?
There's another video, though, on Fenton.
Yes.
That was posted today.
So there's another video. I had a wonderful client who I actually haven't seen for 4 years. I met this dog at 6 months old, and now it's almost four, so 3.5 years, who, it's a couple that came up, and I did a 3-hour session with them. I am still training dogs. Well, I started training dogs back here now. You can book private sessions with Jeff. So they did a 3.5 session with me, hour session with me. They came up from Brooklyn, and what we did was, Fenton was actually right about in this location, I believe. All we did was we put him in place.
Off leash,
and we just said, that's it. And then we spent probably an hour in this room with three people all moving around that he's never really seen that much. Two strangers. And a strange dog, and they were moving, and the guy Pino, really great guy, he likes to snap his fingers a lot and point a lot, and I kept yelling at them. I don't know if you see that, and then I'm like, stop snapping your fingers and stop you yelling and stop saying wait. And it's been almost 4 years, so they, you know. Anyway, the point being is he literally just said, look at the training going on over there. And hey guys, don't worry about it. I'm just hanging here chilling out. Huge, huge. Now, for some people, they might be like, what's the big deal? But man, you haven't walked in the footsteps of Fenton's owner. You haven't walked in the footsteps of many dogs' owners. So, all three of those videos, I'm super proud of my staff. Damn good display of dog training. So watch those three videos, and now you'll be like, oh, I get it. And I'm not trying to, I don't want to say we try to dumb down our videos, but remember, our market is dog owners, and that doesn't mean we have to dumb down them, but we want folks to understand why we're doing it, what we're doing it, but also try to read, when you read in the narrative, what stage they're at. This is one thing that we do that not a lot of people do. We absolutely show the intake if we can get it. We historically show the I hate to use the word finished product, the go home session, but we show the middle. And a lot of times it's messy. Why do most trainers not show it? Because of the hate they get. We show it, why? Because we're we know that a lot of our audience either geographically or financially can't afford us. And we want them to know that they're on the right track, and we want them to know how to do it, because there's no secrets at all. It's a lot easier for us to make one video and put it out there so thousands of people can learn from it. And the video stays there forever, because then this video will be turned into a YouTube video by Melissa, and it'll go up on her YouTube channel. So three really great videos, and I used to do a ton of lives, and from what I hear, I'm gonna have to start doing more of them because people really enjoy them, and these talking head ones are really, really great. So is there any questions at all? Maybe 5-10 minutes of questions at all? Any mm-hmm. clarity at all?
Yeah, I can give you the phone.
Okay, sure. And... oh, I'm gonna get the phone? Oh, thank you. So, let's see, reinforcing a better decision, excellent. Okay, is David says, is it better or worse to teach out for drop and leave, for leave me alone? It's up to you. So David, I didn't recognize you because there was no $4.99 donation before that. This is the thing, these are English words. So if you say drop or leave it, and the dog does what you want it to do, it doesn't make a difference. Can you explain to people why you can use out for both releasing an object and moving away? Can you explain for people why? Why? Because it works. I believe that dogs think contextually. For instance, last night's podcast, we had five dogs all relaxing, and I said, I probably said the word break 30 times, and at the end I said break, 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 break on camera, and none of the dogs broke, because why? They knew I wasn't talking to them. But then I finally, when we had the camera off, I said break, and all the dogs got up. I believe when a dog has a ball in its mouth and I say out, it doesn't run away from me, it spits out the ball. When I'm playing tug with a dog and I say out, it releases the tug. And then I give it the bite command, and it bites it. When a dog comes up to me and it's getting in, it's nose bagging me or getting in my way, when I say out, the dog moves away. All these things were trained, by the way. So contextually, when you train each thing, the dog understands what you want, because they get it. Michelle, out has saved me from a monster-sized pit mastiff. He's so big and gets in my way and tries to keep me go through the house. Yeah, out makes him get out of the way. Yep, absolutely. And then Karen, while watching this video, I used the out command on my Mal. It was annoying the cat who jumped up on my lap. Exactly. So great commands to do. A lot more clarity right there for everybody, I hope. So madly in love with all of you guys. Thank you so much. Thanks for all the wonderful comments. Thanks for all the wonderful questions. And I really, really appreciate, you know, all of you. All right, take care. Time to go run some errands. Love you guys. Bye-bye.
Lucas here. Good boy. Place. Good boy. Lucas here. Place.
Trainer coming to the house, and she was doing something with cups, like, and there was a treat under the cups. Then he just lunged at her, and he did bite her and break the skin.
He was a puppy. He bit my finger, and he drew blood and everything. He reacted. I went to try to put the leash on him. Mm-hmm. He just really reacted real fast.
Up. Go ahead. Girl. Girl, break.
Keep going.
I got in front of every single dog in not even a minute.
Do another lap. Keep going. Don't stop. One more lap. Nice.
Stanley here, the boy.
He would lunge it at strangers. It was just, we couldn't go to outdoor cafes. We couldn't have people over without being afraid that we might be putting our guests at risk.
He was extremely volatile and unpredictable.
We were really frightened that we might not be able to keep this dog. The fact that we're going to be able to have people over and he's going to sit quietly in his crate, and the fact that he can sit in a place like that, it's going to transform our lives, and we're going to be able to keep him, and he's going to keep growing.